JamesOn Curry's journey to the NBA was long. His career was significantly shorter, and the contrast between the two makes for a fascinating story. When people hear the phrase, cup of coffee, they think of just that, a cup of coffee. However, us people in the sports world, we use it as an expression to describe a player whose playing career lasted exactly one game. At the time of this recording, the NBA has seen 64 players meet that criteria, one of which being North Carolina native JamesOn Curry, who holds the record for having the NBA's shortest career. Curry, who is unrelated to Steph, Seth, Dell, and the rest of the Curry clan, made his debut for the Los Angeles Clippers on January 25th, 2010. He played for 4 seconds, and then merely hours later, he was unemployed. Following the contest, Curry said, quote, "It was the quickest 4 seconds ever. I wish it would have lasted longer. Being out there, I just felt like a regular person, felt like a regular basketball player. I felt like I was home, like this is where I belonged." Throughout the years, North Carolina has produced a copious amount of NBA talent. Not only have the players been talented, some of them have gone on to carve out Hall of Fame level careers, including the likes of Michael Jordan, Chris Paul, Steph Curry, and Pete Maravich. JamesOn Curry, whose unique pronunciation of his name comes from a combination of his father, Leon, and his uncle, James, was born in Pleasant Grove, North Carolina, and the beginning of his basketball journey looked very similar to the people who I mentioned just a couple seconds ago. From an early age, JamesOn Curry was exceptionally talented, and people took notice. Curry's slick dribbling and dead-eye shooting made him an exciting player to watch, but also a voluminous scorer, and he excelled as soon as he joined the team at East Alamance High School. As a freshman, Curry totaled 639 points. The next year, he continued to assert his will on his contemporaries and racked up 892 points. Much of the same happened during Curry's junior season, where he nearly eclipsed the 1,000-point mark, finishing with 972. As a senior, he posted averages of 40.2 points, 7.3 rebounds, and 6 assists. He was a star, and college coaches couldn't help but become infatuated with the slender point guard who finished his high school career with a then record 3,307 points. 247 Sports respected Curry enough to rank him 80th overall in a 2004 class that was just absolutely loaded. You had guys like Dwight Howard, Sean Livingston, Sebastian Telfair, Al Jefferson, LaMarcus Aldridge. The class was absolutely stacked. And in the state of North Carolina, there were only 4 players who 247 Sports thought were better than JamesOn Curry. Overall, they gave him a composite rating of 96.83, which wasn't that far behind Roy Bright, who was considered the best player in the state at that time. The numbers and rankings notwithstanding, one thing was undeniable. College coaches wanted JamesOn Curry on their team, and one of them just happened to be Roy Williams, who was the coach at the University of North Carolina. Curry reciprocated that feeling and went on to sign his national letter of intent with the North Carolina Tar Heels. They offered him a scholarship, and it was pretty much a relationship that was destined to be. Curry, being a North Carolina native, would play at one of the most competitive schools in the state. Unfortunately, it did not turn out that way. As a senior, Curry unknowingly sold weed to an undercover police officer on school grounds. This type of transaction happened twice, once in the bathroom and then once in the school parking lot. Curry, however, did not act alone. The local police did a huge sweep and wound up arresting 49 people, including JamesOn Curry. Overall, when it was all said and done, JamesOn Curry, who was a high school senior at the time, pled guilty to 6 felonies. And all of them were related to his distribution and possession of marijuana. When this got back to Roy Williams and the University of North Carolina, they wanted absolutely nothing to do with this young man. They rescinded their scholarship offer, and it looked like JamesOn Curry was going to spend, maybe not the rest of his life behind bars, but a decent amount of his adult life would be served in jail thanks to this sting operation. Regarding the matter, Roy Williams said, quote, "It was the best decision for the university as well as the young man." Every so often, we cross paths with people in our lives that unknowingly or knowingly shape our destiny and shift the path that we're going on. In JamesOn Curry's life, this person was Justice Kenneth C. Titus, and he is single-handedly responsible for allowing Curry to go on and pursue his dream of playing college basketball. Now, remember, Curry is 17 years old and going to court for 6 felony drug charges. It's just mind-blowing to think about. 17, and he is dealing with God knows how many years behind bars. I don't think it was specified anywhere, but let's just say that it was probably a lot. And fortunately, Judge Titus looked at this young man, felt that he was remorseful for what he did, and felt that he learned from this experience, and allowed him to not walk away free, but walk away with no jail time. And he could be, in theory, a free man, not serve any time behind bars. In total, Curry was sentenced to 36 months of probation and 200 hours of community service. Now, with that all out of the way, Curry was allowed to sign with whatever school wanted to sign him and continue his basketball career. America is the land of second chances. More often than not, people deserve a chance at redemption, especially when they're in JamesOn Curry's shoes, a kid who made a mistake, because at the end of the day, that's what he was. He was a kid who made a mistake. Now, for Curry to go ahead and continue his basketball career, a university would have had to approach him with the opportunity for him to play for them. The university was Oklahoma State, and the head coach was Eddie Sutton. Sutton was deep into his tenure with the Cowboys, and OSU was one of those colleges that had shown interest in Curry before the whole drug bust. Now that UNC had pulled out, him and Oklahoma State had the chance to build something great together. JamesOn Curry joined a university led by a coach who had experienced significant success during his tenure with the school. Sutton had been there for 14 seasons, and they missed the NCAA tournament just twice. They also went on to 2 Final Fours, one in 1995 and the second in 2004. Led by Joey Graham and John Lucas, Oklahoma State went 26-7 during Curry's rookie year. They were undeniably one of the best teams in the nation and finished 6th in the AP poll for that season. They made quick work of Southeastern Louisiana in the NCAA tournament and then skated by Southern Illinois, advancing to the Sweet 16 by a score of 85-77. For the season, Curry averaged a modest 9.4 points, but came up huge in the second postseason game, dropping 18 points on 3-of-5 shooting. And as you can see, the majority of his scoring came from the free throw line. In the Sweet 16, OSU fell to a very talented Arizona Wildcats team, and Curry managed just 11 points in that contest. Although his numbers weren't spectacular, Curry proved that he could be productive when given the opportunity. Extrapolated on a per 40-minute basis, Curry averaged 15.3 points and 4.6 assists. Additionally, he shot 47.4% overall and 43.3% from the three-point line. With Graham and Lucas leaving for the NBA, the Cowboys were now JamesOn Curry's team to lead. He, along with junior Mario Boggan, split leadership duties, but the season did not mimic the previous ones. Oklahoma State finished with just 17 wins that season and were a piddling 6-10 in conference play. And as you might expect, their mediocrity caused them to miss the NCAA tournament. Compounding matters was that Curry did not improve as much as some people might have expected. His scoring rose to 13.5 points per game. However, it was mostly the result of a drastic jump in minutes. This man went from averaging about 25 per game to being more than 34 on any given night. More, his shooting was just awful. Overall, he shot 39 38.8% from the floor, and that was boosted considerably by a still respectable 37.6% clip from the three-point line. The negatives, though, Curry was only a sophomore, and he was still adjusting to a completely different role. This guy went from being the third or fourth best player on the team to having to be the catalyst basically overnight. There was no adjustment period. He was just kind of thrown into it and forced to adapt. Not many collegiate players can fulfill that role. So obviously you would think that it would take at least another year for him to get acclimated. With that year of leadership under his belt, Curry's junior season turned out to be his best. He looked like someone who could bear the load of having to be a team's first option. He was a polished scorer and still maintained great percentages from the line. Moreover, Curry demonstrated that on any night, he could go shot for shot with some of the best players in the conference and also in the country. Curry's scoring improved again. This time he finished the season at 17.3 points per game. However, this was the result of him refining his shot. Curry finished second in the Big 12 in made threes and was fourth in three-point percentage. Unfortunately, Oklahoma State again failed to make the postseason tournament despite finishing this season with a 22-13 record. Those three campaigns with the Cowboys cemented JamesOn Curry as a legitimate NBA player. He was a formidable scorer who thrived because of his creativity. Because he wasn't the biggest guy, a lot of Curry's efficacy was because of his craftiness, but it doesn't matter how you get points in the NBA as long as you can get points consistently and reliably. Guys across the NBA knew that JamesOn Curry could get a bucket. That was not a concern. Their concerns were on the defensive end. Despite having decent athleticism and a sizable wingspan, Curry was not a good defender. And with a lot of guys, it just comes down to effort. He had minimal effort in playing defense, and maybe some of that is the result of him having to bear such a low on offense. Regardless, it was not something that scouts really liked about him. Additionally, we know how sports franchises can be when it comes to drafting guys with blemishes on their record, and I'm not saying whether or not that is a legitimate concern. I'm just saying that folks across the NBA probably thought they would be taking on a headache, and that probably hit his draft stock harder than everything else. Looking back on his body of work and the resume that he produced in college, Curry decided to enter his name in the 2007 NBA draft. He did so knowing that he would be one of the 60 players taken that night. And he went on to tell ESPN's Royce Young that the Chicago Bulls promised that they'd draft him 51st overall. Using that same resume that we just talked about, some could argue that Curry deserved to go a little bit higher, maybe early second round, late first round. Regardless, that isn't really a point of contention. Like, no one, he wasn't too concerned about his draft spot, mainly because he knew that he was going to get off the board at some point. On the night of the draft, it would take nearly 3 years for JamesOn Curry to make his NBA debut. His trek was turbulent, and that's putting it mildly. Curry's first stop post-college was in the NBA's G League. Now, for the sake of continuity, I'm going to refer to what was then named the D League to the G League. So it's the same league, same everything. The only reason the name is different is because I think Gatorade bought the rights to the league and they changed the D to an L. Whatever, doesn't matter. It's just really semantics, but that's just for continuity's sake. So his first stop was in the G League. And to be fair to Curry, he did put up some pretty spectacular numbers. He averaged 22.2 points and 5.5 assists on 46.3% shooting, numbers that mimicked what he put up in college, and just again continued to show that this guy had the skill set to play in the NBA. It was just a matter of what role would he occupy. Unfortunately, after playing so well, Curry had another run-in with the police. Reports said that the 22-year-old was arrested outside of his hotel at 2:30 a.m. on January 17th, 2008. His charges: urinating in public and resisting arrest. both of which were misdemeanors, Curry walked away after posting $600 bond. While that incident with the police wasn't as severe as his first one, it was enough for the Chicago Bulls to issue a one-game suspension. After the suspension, Chicago held on to Curry before waiving him that July. Now technically a free agent, JamesOn Curry pursued an international basketball career, and he went on to sign with, excuse me while I butcher this name, Pau Orthez, which was one of France's premier basketball clubs. His stint did not last that long. He played just 38 minutes in two games, and Curry was yet again back on the job hunt. He returned to the United States, signing with the G League's Iowa Energy, and also spending some time with the Springfield Armor, where he continued to post respectable numbers. During the 2009-2010 campaign with the Armor, Curry posted the G League's fourth highest assist per game average with 7.1 per game. Despite Curry's numbers, many people outside of the NBA did not pay attention to the minor leagues. Back in the early 2010s, the G League was nothing like how it was today. As of right now, in 2021, the G League has an abundance of talent, which forces anybody that plays in that league to improve at a much faster rate than anybody else. It's also a legitimate path for top high school prospects to go if they want to avoid college and make some legal compensation for their services. But when Curry played, it was significantly different, and it's not a knock to anyone that played in the league at that time. I'm just saying that the talent pool was nothing like what it was today. Now, with all of that said, it's not a surprise that Curry signing with the Los Angeles Clippers did not generate many headlines. In fact, the article that Ramona Shelburne wrote for ESPN wasn't even centered on signing Curry. It was about an injury that Sebastian Telfair had sustained. Curry, of course, was included because he replaced Kareem Rush, who was out with a torn ACL. Curry joined a Clippers team that was slightly below average. While not incredibly talented, they boasted a 20-23 record heading into a game against the Boston Celtics, a game where JamesOn Curry would finally make his NBA debut. The roster boasted some notable names, including Chris Kaman, Baron Davis, and Eric Gordon. That three was Mike Dunleavy's big three, and Gordon, who was 21 years old at the time, appeared to be the franchise's next centerpiece. Los Angeles was doing fine and working with what they had. Curry probably wasn't going to have a tremendous impact on the team. Regardless, everybody still welcomed him with open arms. Longtime veteran Ricky Davis stepped up and became a mentor to Curry. They just wanted him to feel confident and overall just feel comfortable. The night of Curry's debut, the Los Angeles Clippers faced not just any regular old Boston Celtics team. This Celtics team featured Rajon Rondo, Kevin Garnett, Ray Allen, and Paul Pierce, and were less than two calendar years removed from bringing home a championship. In fact, they would later march to the NBA Finals that season and lose in seven games to the Los Angeles Lakers. In short, this was a stacked team. This was a beast of teams. This was one of the original super teams that JamesOn Curry would make his debut against. Even with all of that said, good teams do have bad games sometimes, and the Boston Celtics were not playing at their best that Wednesday night. Going into halftime, the Clippers held a 44-43 lead, the type of score that many of today's teams could replicate in 15 minutes. As the third quarter progressed, however, the Celtics got into a rhythm and were led by a young Rajon Rondo, who went on to finish with 16 points and 12 assists. But it was in the third quarter where JamesOn Curry finally achieved his dream. The 24-year-old entered the game for Chris Kaman. Boston inbounded, the clock ticked down to zero, and then, just like that, JamesOn Curry's NBA career would be over shortly thereafter. As I mentioned in the intro, the Clippers released Curry mere hours after that game, and they did so in order to make room for Bobby Brown, a second-year player who was coming over from the New Orleans Pelicans. In the aftermath of that disappointment, Curry again found himself in the G League with none other than the Springfield Armor. Little had changed, and Curry remained impactful on the basketball court because he was entering his athletic prime. 2010-11 campaign with Springfield saw him average 15.5 points and 3.5 assists. Following season, he was even better, averaging 17.3 points and 6.3 assists, numbers that were good enough to earn him a G League All-Star selection. In that game, Curry scored 25 points in 24 minutes for the East and narrowly missed out on winning the All-Star Game MVP. He lost to Gerald Green, who had 28 points that game. After that second torrid stretch where he just dominated the G League, some could argue that Curry deserved another shot at the NBA. He was still young, he still had game, and I'm sure that a team could have used him as some sort of spark plug on the bench or a second unit scoring option, and unfortunately, it just never happened. Bob McKinnon, who was the Armor's coach at the time, talked to ESPN's Royce Young and said that he also felt Curry deserved to be called up again that year, saying, quote, "We had three call-ups that season, and I thought JamesOn would be the next guy. It still bothers me to this day that he wasn't." I'm sure Coach McKinnon is not the only guy who's still bothered by this. Curry finished out that season with Springfield, went over to Europe again, and then again came back to the NBA's G League. This time around, he was with the Bakersfield Jam and played the 2013-14 season with them. That campaign proved to be Curry's last. In total, he split 24 games between Bakersfield and Springfield, and it was the worst basketball of JamesOn Curry's professional career. His minutes fell drastically to 26.3, and he posted just 7 points and 4.2 assists while posting a miserable shooting clip of 38.1%. In March, Curry hurt his ankle, he got waived, and his career was effectively over. Some might look at JamesOn Curry's basketball career and see him as a failure. He didn't really, he made it to the NBA, but he didn't have a long stay. He wasn't an impactful player. There were a lot of inconsistencies with him going overseas and him bouncing back and forth between various G League teams, but you could look at it that way if you wanted to be pessimistic about it. Some people might instead look at JamesOn Curry's story and see just an excruciating amount of perseverance, especially for a guy whose career has had significant highs and equally significant lows. I mean, this guy had been convicted of multiple crimes and is also one of the best players that the state of North Carolina has ever produced. I mean, it's a remarkable story, again, littered with perseverance. And with that, it's a remarkably relatable tale for so many of us. Not everybody can relate to being a professional athlete, but everybody has experienced stuff that Curry has experienced. Just being in it and going through the trenches and being able to come out of it, you know, alive, healthy, whatever. Just being perseverant. That's the only way I can describe it. And although it didn't work out for JamesOn Curry, at least he can say that he tried and he knew that it wouldn't work out after trying multiple times. Thank you guys so much for coming to hang out with me and listening to my retelling of one of the most unique stories in sports history. Everything that I'm associated with will be down in the description. I also want to give a shout out to ESPN's Royce Young, who wrote up a feature on JamesOn Curry a couple years ago. It is significantly more compelling than anything I just said, and I will also leave a link for that down in the description. If you're looking for an enthralling read, I highly suggest you check it out. And as always, thank you guys again, and I'll see y'all in the next one.